Bath's character is its single greatest asset, and it defines how we live, how we work, and to what we ascribe value. How we read this character and what we know about how it came about is something we need to know better in how we understand how to move Bath towards a more liberal city. Too often we reduce it to Georgian Bath, some untouchable relic that we can't inhabit without leaving a mark. The character becomes monoculture, and any deviation, regardless of his origin, is always going to be out of keeping and to be resisted. It's a fundamental obstruction to how we become a more liberal city. As long as the city's identity remains limited to satisfying a 200-year-old condition, trying to integrate new narratives, new infrastructure, new typologies is always going to cause tension. UNESCO sees the city's character as being broader. Our World Heritage citation recognises a continuing development of two millennia as being a significant living city and not a static museum. Georgian architecture is critical to the city's identity, but its character is a product of all the stories that have been left by every generation and every era. It's the city founded by a stronghold that was surrendered to Cromwell. We've been shaped by bombers, and by planners, and by a bypass that never happened. Managing a plural character is much harder than packaging and commodifying a single narrative. And our industrial heritage interferes with this very simple Georgian narrative. With the smoke and labour of Brunel's railway and Stutham pit works being in stark contrast to Ralph Allen's gold and stone. In prioritising one unquestionably significant narrative above all others, anything which is not Georgian becomes diminished. This limited character creates an environment where that which does not appear Georgian may be overwritten for the sake of uniformity, staged for tourists in the most superficial of readings. And we do this by degrees. Last year, the railing spikes along Lansdowne Crescent were restored by the Residents Association, with the missing finials repaired to restore an air of completeness along the crescent. Most of the spikes have been donated by individual residents as part of a drive, part of a wartime drive to recycle scrap metal for some armaments. Much of what was collected was surplus to requirements and secretly dumped or buried. But the value of the campaign was as a source of national unity, we saw it continue. Their absence from garden walls across the city, marked by little stubs of iron embedded in lead plug, is a monument to this story. And propaganda or not, it acts as a reminder of another time when the city's fabric was shaped by war and remembered in a quiet memorial. In restoring the image of integrity of a complete and unbroken Georgian Crescent, a small part of the city's history is lost. The false sense of completeness reduces the Crescent's authenticity. When you can't differentiate between the old and the new, you can't read the story of how it came to be. By addressing our own interventions to one particular fragment of the city's character, we're staging a diminished and falsely uniform cityscape. The city's character becomes paper thin by denying space for old stories to be told and for new stories to grow.
Yeah. And then, but fear not, because when we do tell our other stories and when we celebrate them, we do it really well. A really good example was King Vlad's Pigs in Bath. It was in 2008, an art project, which allowed both the artists and the visitors to reconnect with this mythical father figure that founded the city of Bath. By celebrating the heritage, it also created a new legacy by creating funds to help celebrate the industrial heritage and reuse in a creative way the railway lines forming the two tunnel greenway. This linear park celebrates the heritage but also creates a new lease of life and makes our city more scenic and livable. Similarly, the bus wrapping, the development of the recreational grounds has a significant impact on the modern city of Bath and the character it has. The current stadium might be a bit uninspiring, but it's at odds with the original intention. But if you ever visit the city on the day of the home match, you can see that it creates a very strong shared identity. And it's a very similar occasion to the promenade hour, with people kind of walking through the city to see and to be seen, which is fantastic. With the ongoing conversations about moving the wreck out of the city centre, we might restore the site to a more public site, as it was originally intended, but we might lose a bit of the character that makes it so great. I mean, the wreck has created a sporting legacy and a new identity for Bath, and it's woven into the city centre image. The character of the city, whilst dominated by the Georgian era, it is a product of all times and all places, and it's richer when we allow all the stories to be told. There are always going to be tensions between the different stories, but we have to carry this narrative, and we have to be actively involved in how we create and recreate and how to retell these stories. Limiting the number of stories that are allowed to be told simply to have a very simple and clear narrative might be detrimental not only to the authentic heritage, but also to the essence of the place that makes it so great. The main message that we want to come across is that the history starts today. We can build on the stories of the past without building over them. We need to decide how we live with them, how we adapt them, and how this narrative will help us build the city of tomorrow.